couple of minutes past 7. I'd like to do, first of all, to see if any of the board members have any comments on the previous meeting notes from March 15th. I would like to state this meeting has been rescheduled from last Tuesday to this evening to accommodate staff schedules, and we appreciate everyone coming on the special evening. With that, are there any comments regarding last meeting's meeting notes? Any comments?
Just checking. Good job, Alice.
Could I hear a motion then?
I move that we accept the minutes from the March 15th planning board meeting as written.
Second.
All those in favor? Passes unanimously. Until Peter shows up, I'd like to appoint Roy as a voting member this evening. Judy Lardner will not be here. We have in front of us a long list of correspondence that we've received in our packet, and those include a letter from the town manager regarding the planning board and department budget, school building committee meeting notes. We appreciate receiving the meeting notes. They're very helpful in reviewing the plans and getting what could be considered to be privileged information, although they are open to the public. Memorandum from the town manager regarding the school project. I believe that's one that refers to the easements. Oh, that's finance, okay. The school building committee meeting notes from March 24th and April 7th, and environmental development newsletters from the American Planning Association, which the town planner has distributed, also very informative. Memorandum from the town manager regarding land on Ocean House Road. Did everyone get a chance to review that? Memorandum from the town manager regarding land encroachments, and I'm sure we'll get into some discussions on that when we get into review of the school project. Flyer regarding wetlands and bridges, again, very informative, good cost information. Wetlands regulation paper, which I think was sold by the pound. It's certainly a lengthy document. Environmental development newsletter, collaborative negotiation skills workshop. If any of the members of the planning board are interested in that, would you please let Maureen know? And a letter from the town attorney regarding Rosewood subdivision.
Mr. Chair?
Yes, Mr. Arthur.
Question I have on the correspondence from the town manager. It sounds like it's asking for a recommendation to us, from us. Is that something we should take up in other business at the end of the agenda?
The town manager is here. Why don't we ask him? Were you looking for a formal vote from the board? Then why don't we do that after the regular agenda? Okay. Any other items to discuss under correspondence? With that, then, we'll proceed with old business. The only item on this evening's agenda for old business is the middle school building project. And I would like to remind everyone that this is a public hearing. What we'll be doing is asking the applicant to make a brief or concise presentation with respect to the recent changes since the last meeting before, the completeness meeting before the planning board. And then if there are any members of the public who would like to speak either in favor or against the project, we'll ask them to do that. At the end of the public comment, we'll close the public comment officially, so to speak, and then ask for a rebuttal from the applicant on any issues that they would like to rebut. And at that point, we'll then turn it over for planning board comments and questions. With that, I'd ask the representative of the applicant please to proceed to the podium and begin your presentation.
Thank you. My name is Paul Stevens. I think everybody here knows who I am. I'm a principal at SMRT. And along with our group tonight, Ellen Belknap is here, and Ellen, as you know, is the project architect for the schools. Dennis Judd is a landscape architect sitting next to her. Jerry Audibear, our civil engineer, and Bill Bray, the traffic consultant. And we also, in addition, have members from the school administration and board here and building committee as well. Since we were here at the last meeting, we have met with you all for a site walk. We have met and consulted with the DEP on several occasions. We have reviewed wetlands issues with Jay Clement, the Army Corps of Engineers. We've met with Chief McGoldrick, Chief Pickering, Maureen O'Meara, Ernie McVane, Rick Churchill, the Zoning Board, and T.Y. Lynn, and many of these people more than once in pursuing some of the issues that have come up during the design and that were raised the last time. Since our last meeting, we've also submitted our application to the DEP and expect approval before we go to bid on June 23rd. We've generated a fair amount of additional information for you, most of which you have requested, and there may be a few odds and ends of things here that I'll have eliminated, but in the broad picture and the major things that have been submitted to you are a memo from Bill Bray, which you requested reviewing and approving the internal site circulation. We have created a photographic computer enhancement, as you can see over there on your right, showing the existing view from Scott Dyer Road and what it will look like from the same spot when the project is completed. We have developed elevations of the courtyard, which you received, I think, in your packet for tonight, and are also shown in black and white below the colored elevation of the front entrances to the two schools. We have, I believe, with us tonight the letter from the Portland Water District, which testifies to the adequacy of service for the project. We have presented a tree preservation plan for review. As I mentioned, we had met with the Army Corps of Engineers, and we've also met with other people and have clarified the wetland issues in regard to the project. And we have a memo within the last few days from Mr. McVane, who certifies that there are, in fact, no permits required of that sort for this project. I believe one of the memos that you addressed in your list was the memo from Mike McGovern in regard to the encroachment issue, which you expressed a desire to discuss at this meeting. We've also submitted and clarified additional pieces on the phasing plans that were developed, and I think the drawings, as you have most recently received them, have clarified what is included in the project. Another question that you had to do with asbestos debris from the project, and that will be going to a licensed facility. There obviously will be some, want to leave some flexibility in terms of where we're able to take that, but our understanding is that it's going to go to the turnkey landfill in Rochester, New Hampshire. We've also made a number of changes to the project in response to your comments and also to the design as it's continued to develop. The first of those is that we have eliminated Jordan Way as a bus entrance, and the buses will now access the project through the high school entrance. We've also moved the bus equipment storage building to a corner of the parking lot, and we've also managed to get that approved by the zoning board, and that's right here. It was located there. We've added an esplanade and trees to the entrance drive as requested. And we've also added islands and trees in the parking lot, which was requested at the walkthrough. We've also, since we've done that, received a memo from the Public Works Director notifying us of his concerns about the islands for plowing purposes. We've added a pedestrian walkway to the old high school, which is a circular walkthrough here. And after consultation with the DEP, town officials, and T.Y. Lynn, We've determined how to handle the site drainage, which was undetermined at the last time that we met. And as a result of that, we have added a stormwater detention basin, which is located, right here, this area here. And by doing this, we've managed to maintain the same post-development flows as we have for pre-development flows off of the property. And also, the design is now coordinated to accept future town center drainage. We revised the site lighting to eliminate the bollard lights that we had shown. This was done at the request of Dan Reed, who's the facilities person from the school department, and Dan was concerned about vandalism and damage to these light bollards. And lastly, we've added a sign, as you requested, designating the entrance to the middle school from the courtyard, which, if you look real close, you can see over on one of those elevations over there. As you know, T.Y. Lynn has generated technical concerns, which we have been addressing with them on an ongoing basis. Most of their comments, we believe, involve resolution of final construction details. There are two outstanding issues, however, and those are their review of the detention basin design, which was only recently developed, so they haven't had a chance to see that, and also their final review of our drainage calculations. At the last meeting, we did not discuss Maureen's memo of March 15th in detail with you, but as you can see from her memo of April 25th, most of the issues have, the substantial issues have been addressed. It appears to us that everybody is in agreement on the major project concepts, or at least we certainly hope so, but we do recognize that there are still some technical issues to resolve, and we look forward to getting your comments this evening. Thanks.
Thank you. With that, what I'd like to do is open the meeting for a public hearing and ask that anyone who wishes to speak before the meeting stand up and introduce yourself and give your name and address. At this point, is there anyone who would like to speak either in favor or against the project? Yes.
Michael Hill, Hillway.
Would you please stand up to the microphone, please?
My name is Michael Hill from 12 Hill Way. And my only concern is that this is a major pedestrian corridor between a very large neighborhood, which they don't have on the map, and Holman Field and Capano Field and the high school and the tennis courts and basically the whole school complex, and they've just shut it right off, closed it right in. And it really, I went to all those town center planning committees, you know, meetings, town center committee of the planning board, and it seems to me to go entirely against the entire comprehensive. Thank you.
You're welcome. Thank you. Is anyone else have any comments? With that, I'd also like to enter into the record a letter that was received from Janet Hill of 12 Hill Way. I think it would be safe to say that it's very brief. I'll go ahead and read it. It says, Planning Board, Town of Cape Elizabeth, dear members, I note in the Cape Courier that you are concerned that the long driveways into the school complex will not be pedestrian friendly. Has it not occurred to anyone during this whole long process that the placement of this new building as presently planned will ruin forever any chance we might have had for an open space and pedestrian friendly town center? Very truly yours, Janet Hill. Once again, any other comments from the public? Hearing none, I'll officially close the public hearing and ask that the applicant would wish to respond to the public concern just raised, to please do so.
I don't really think I have much to say to that. It's certainly I can't dispute the fact of the matter that we are blocking off the mall that continues that goes down through the complex at this point in time. I think the only thing I can add is that there has been over the last year and a half considerable discussion about the merits of either connecting the schools or disconnecting the schools, and it was certainly the very carefully considered opinion of the building committee and that this was the appropriate solution to the school project, and that solution has been communicated to the town and to this body on numerous occasions in the course of that, and that tonight is the first time that I've heard that particular comment in terms of concern for cutting off that pedestrian route through there. And I might add that there are obviously other ways around the project rather than right through the middle of it, so.
For the record, would you just please point out how you've accommodated pedestrian circulation through the project?
Well, we've developed this walkway in Esplanade, which goes right down, right through here.
And is there also one along the right-hand side of the building? The east side?
There's also a way to walk through here as well.
Okay.
Actually, it's fenced in the hand.
As part of the access, both from the bus loop and from the this portion of the site, as well as from this portion of town and through the site, we have provided that walk, and it also includes a gate at that fence that will be allowed to swing open clearly for kids to come both ways through there.
Thank you. At this point, what I'd like to do is to ask the planning board to please address any questions or comments to the applicant so that if there's anything leading to the vote that we can make the applicant aware of. Mr. Edsel?
Since Judy's not here, I'll go first. She always usually goes first. I have a list of questions. First of all, I want to thank the applicant for providing us with some very nice visuals. I also appreciate a number of the changes made to the plan, especially the entrance traffic, the bus traffic. I know there were some hard feelings and some words spoken about the involvement of the planning board and so forth. And I just think in the long run, even though we may be increasing the usage of the high school entranceway, the overall plan for the school campus itself, I hope everybody sees. I think that it's an improvement on the entire site, and in the planning over the next decade or 15 years, the concentration of traffic in the public works area, in conjunction with the Pond Cove Shopping Center, I was just extremely concerned, as I think the department heads were, with the amount of traffic that would be coming in and out of there. Number of questions I have. First of all, during the site walk, there was a question asked. The existing basketball courts, which may have originally been designed as tennis court, was a gift from, I don't know whether it was the Sprague family or the Sprague Corporation, and we asked if it could be checked into if there were any conditions placed on that gift. It was just while we were there, if you remember, there's a plaque on a rock. I don't think we'd ever seen it before. That was a gift. And have you had a chance to see if there are any conditions of that gift?
Yes and no. I had talked with Sue Weatherby about it to get her sense of what the status of that was, given there was an athletic facility, and she had some recollection of its being a gift, but thought I'd best check with Mike McGovern about that to see, because it was a gift to the town and not to the school. Mm. So I've sent a memo to Mike, but we haven't, the mail hasn't caught up with us yet.
Okay. I'd like to see that followed up with. I just got some media attention in Portland that a gift was being torn, or a structure was being torn that was torn down. It was a $50,000 gift from a resident there. I think we should take a look at that. I'm looking for comments from the applicant as to their preference of either having a fence or not having a fence screening the school bus parking area at the IGA parking lot, which abuts the IGA parking lot. When we were on the site walk, there seemed to be some concern for security, that it's a great place to hide behind that fence while we're parking thousands of dollars worth of school bus equipment there at the same time. the trade-off between the screening visually, those school buses. Is there a preference from the applicant?
Well, my understanding is that there's a fence there right now which does screen the view, and I guess, is your question one of concern for security?
Maybe I misunderstood the reading that we're looking at a 5-foot wooden fence, solid fence. There's a, I believe there's a chain link fence there now, which is not as noticeable. There's shrubs growing in that location and so forth, which I think, my own personal opinion, if there's no preference by the planning board, that we not, simply not change that, that we don't put up a 5 or 6-foot solid fence, but leave that open.
You'll let Dennis suggest that.
There was, you're right, there were conflicting issues about that. One was the security and one was visual access. And what we wanted also not to promote was through pedestrian traffic through the center of the bus parking area. Rather, it would be better to get them around the sides where visibility was better and where there wasn't an inclination or desire or temptation to hang out between the buses. And there is a hole in the fence or a pedestrian access way in that fence in three locations. One right at the end, one in the center, and one on this side, end of the current fence situation. So there, from that perspective, we felt, well, we can't really close off that middle section of the existing chain link fence of somebody else's property. So that was one reason to keep the fence, to let the pedestrians move around the outside. The other reason was that we have also provided for a small guardrail and block heaters for the buses. And they're apparently on the clunky side, and they're about 4 feet high. And so we felt we could also screen that visually from the town center. So we opted to keep the fence.
Okay, good. The question I had during the sidewalk also pertained to the, I think it was a 15,000-gallon underground storage tank. My question at the time was the size of the truck that required to make that delivery, how often it would have to make those deliveries. We're looking at having portable classrooms there. Do you see any conflict as far as the turning radius of a, I take it it would be a tanker that would have to come in and fill a 15,000-gallon?
No conflict for turning radii. That whole area is designed to accommodate the largest trucks that we have on the highways. We have 50-foot radii at those two turning points right in through here, and there's an easy access and plenty of room. This is about 80 or 100 feet in here, so they can come in either way they want to go. This is the reinforced turf for the fire lane, and so there's plenty of room to maneuver. In terms of the frequency, after discussions with Dan Reed and the kind of oil that we're proposing to use, we can expect that during the heaviest season they'll be filled once a week.
Okay. I'm skipping around a little bit, but perhaps I missed where the outflow of the catch basin 16 and 10, where that actually goes. Those are in the courtyard down the lowest level. Of it. Where's the outflow of that? I lost track of that about at the baseball diamond. Does that?
If you could refresh my memory, which ones are 16 and 10? Is it these?
No.
We've changed the numbers, but I'm a little.
Oh, okay.
In the courtyard.
In the courtyard, area. You know where the 18-inch or the timber wall is inside?
Yes.
That, right up by the building. It's the lowest point in there.
One
right there,
corner.
And one just down below that.
Okay.
I think they go under the building, but where's the outflow from that?
Yeah, all of these basins do tie together and go under the building and continue on, and will eventually come out into the ditch.
So all of it goes through that, the oil grit, the grit oil separator?
No, the revised scheme is, we are proposing two outfalls now. The future town center drainage and all of this drainage here will go through a new pipe into the existing ditch. All of this drainage, which primarily consists of the road and parking areas and some of the roofs, will now be collected into the sediment tank located mm-hmm. at this corner of the parking lot and into the detention basin and then discharge into this existing ditch here. And okay. By doing that, we've been able to maintain discharges below or at today's peaks.
You mentioned a detention area just a little bit earlier. Can you give us some description of what that's going to entail? Is it actually a holding pond or retention pond?
It's intended to be a dry pond. And what will happen for a given rain event, the water will drain into the pond and stay there for several hours, and over the course of 10, 12 hours, and drain out. And there is an emergency spillway that is designed to handle up to a 100-year storm.
I guess the next question is a traffic question. My question has to do with the signage seems to indicate that it's not necessarily advocating but allowing parking on the north side of Scott Dyer Road on weekends. Is there some reason for including parking at all on Scott Dyer? Was that a request of the applicant or?
That maybe Bill can respond to a little bit as well, but during our zoning board review process, that was a recommendation, a request by them to have no parking on Scott Dyer Road at all. And after some discussion, they felt that it was appropriate to have some parking after hours on the north side, but none on the south side. So it's kind of almost a mandate.
Okay. Problematic in that I assume that the people parking there are going to utilize the town facility, the schoolyard, and it'll require them crossing the street to do so. You're saying that it was the zoning board that had requested?
Well, yes, they did. But I think in the final analysis, it's up to the town council and police chief as to where people park and don't park, and that's the recommendation. And it's at this point between it's within the town's hands to resolve that. That's the intent from the zoning board.
Did I miss, or was there no comment from the police chief as to his concerns? I saw the fire chief and Bob Malley's comments. Michael?
Yeah, Michael McGovern, town manager. There was a problem with the zoning board indicating what parking would be allowed on Scott Dyer Road. It's really within the jurisdiction of the town council to do that. This past week, I drafted a proposed school property traffic regulations to substitute for the current ordinance. And the plan is to have that on the town council agenda on Monday, May 9th, to refer that to the school board as well as to the ordinance committee. If you'd like to see it as well, that would be fine. The whole issue does need some attention. What that particular draft recommends is that there be no parking along Scott Dyer Road, and that during the project itself, that the fire chief and police chief be permitted to permit parking in designated areas with designated signs in order to maintain flexibility during the project to ensure that there is parking and to ensure that safety is looked at.
It just seemed to be a health and safety issue, parking on the inside of the curve, even though it's a fairly gradual curve. And most likely all of that parking would be a result in people crossing the street to utilize the town property.
If you look at it now, where the folks are parking, for the most part, it's actually up on the sidewalk, which is an unsafe condition. And with the sidewalk improvement project that's going to be going on there, it just doesn't make any sense to allow parking really on either side through that area. Yeah.
Thank you. Question I had dealing with the entry, there were signs on L-102 indicating at the entrance to the faculty parking lot between the middle school, or the old high school, and the Pond Cove, indicates that there are two signs. One, they both have to do with the main entrance, and I assume that they are signs saying main entrance that away.
Yes.
Okay.
That's correct. The one coming up Scott Dyer Road, main entrance, arrow straight up, and coming up Hillway, main entrance, turn right.
Would it make more sense to indicate that that's faculty parking only, main entrance? I'm just afraid if we have big words, main entrance, no matter which way the arrow points.
We have an employee parking only sign just a little bit farther in.
Okay, I see that now.
It's EP.
Yeah.
It might help to move it up a little bit closer.
Okay. Does the main entrance sign, which is on Dyer Road, which would be on the east side of that, that entrance, block any of the site distance. I would just ask that the applicant take a look at that sign, make sure that it's not at the 42-inch eye level sign, and that it blocks traffic approaching from the east. Some comment also on the main entry sign. I take it that the applicant would just simply appropriately place the main entrance sign out of the site distance of those turning lanes exiting. And I'm talking on the main entrance now.
Right. That, that,
I think there was comment in some narrative.
Yeah, it worked before, but even right now we moved it back 10 more feet. Okay. So it's plenty clear at this point.
The above ground LPG tank proposed, I don't see any enclosure. Aren't those tanks typically enclosed anywhere near a parking, turning access, fire lanes, for plowing reasons? Or is there any regulation on enclosing or putting up standards around gas tanks?
No regulation that I know of to enclose them. It's usually a visual issue to hide them.
Is that gas tank for kitchen facility?
Yes, it is. If we go to gas, which is at this point, I guess, still unresolved, those will not have to be there, obviously, nor will the oil tank.
It appears that there's a large transformer. I take it as just a ground transformer, mm-hmm. right in the vicinity of the portables.
That's correct.
Okay. Does that require any enclosure? I mean, is that something a student can sit on?
Probably so, and it might make sense to have some temporary fencing or something around that.
I think during at least whichever phase it is, phase one or two, that those are handy things to crawl up on, even though you have these big vulture signs on them sitting right beside two portable classrooms. I think that would pose a problem. I know this is going to be a touchy subject, but there's some talk about water source for the portables. What's the status of that discussion right now?
No water in the portables. No sprinklers, no plumbing, no restrooms.
How long?
Electric only.
And I'm looking at, first of all, the middle school portables, which are on the west side of the middle school. How long will those students be in the portables themselves? You know, maybe that's a scheduling issue.
Portables on this side for the middle school. For year one, there will be two portables there. The first year of construction, two portables. Second year of construction, four portables. They will be there for the full year each time.
During the first phase,
which is this,
right, all of the construction will be on the Pond Cove side, is that correct?
Correct. With the exception of the new construction here. There will be no construction on this side of the building during the first phase.
And then the second year, you're proposing all of the portables on the west side?
Correct.
Where's the construction taking place then?
It'll be renovation internal to the building.
Okay. Okay, there's the staging area. Again, I guess my question is, how long are students in these portables with no water, no bathroom sources?
Two school years.
No. I mean, wow, I can't hold it that long.
They will have.
I mean, in any one day, how many hours are they? I'm sorry.
That's
I knew I wasn't leading that right the right way. Sorry.
That is a scheduling issue that perhaps the administration can address specifically. They will have access to bathrooms within the building, and there is close proximity to bathrooms off of the entrance right here.
Okay. I guess my questions would deal with scheduling. How long will students be in those portables? Number two, are there any specific classes that take place in there? 3 years ago, I went through the same discussion when we put the portables on the south end, and they were proposed as dry portables And I said, how can you have students all day long in portables with no water? They can't wash their hands, they can't get a drink of water, no problem. When we're talking about the discussion of the new school, we hear problems, we can't have a science class because we don't have any water. We can't have this class because we don't have water. Kids are always having to leave to go out. I guess that is a question I'd want to see resolved.
We've given some careful consideration to what class functions are housed in those portables. We have located standard classroom functions in them, not art, not science, not music, not other programs that require additional, either access to water or access to equipment.
I just, you know, as one planning board member, I don't understand how students can be in any facility for an entire day. Maybe Connie would like to come to the podium and address the issue that whatever function, my understanding is absolutely no water of any source in those.
Right, and I'm Connie Goldman, the superintendent. I have had considerable experience when I was a superintendent in Gorm and dealing with portable issues, partly from overcrowded school buildings as well as some construction issues. All of them were without water. Many, many school districts throughout the state are dealing with this kind of an issue, and sometimes it's for years that this goes on. The fact that this happens to be a short-term situation certainly, I think, is important to take into consideration. You add enormously to the cost of using portable sort of such as the kind of thing we're using to try to incorporate water. It's very difficult to do that because of the way they're constructed, tied into lines and so forth. The obvious answer to your question as far as how long they are and how does that impact their use, one of the things that we found really important was to include a Poland Spring or whatever, I don't mean to be a commercial here, but a little water cooler in each classroom. Sometimes it has been done where there are two classrooms and you put a water cooler in one if the classrooms are sharing space and so forth. Frankly, my experience has been the kids love it. They love having their own water cooler, so that takes care of that problem. Clearly, the teachers are very willing and able to work out with kids, and I've seen portables used right down to first grade very successfully as far as bathroom breaks and so on. And I've seen kids have to deal with going in and out of buildings at a greater distance than what we have here. So I know for a fact that it can be worked out with some flexibility and that I would not worry about the issue as being really too burdensome. The kids seem to manage pretty well. Some of the complaints people have in advance of these things, what's going to happen when the weather is cold, when it's rainy, when it's muddy, all of those kinds of issues, because their schedule, depending on exactly what grade they're in, the lower grades will be spending the bulk of their time there, but they all leave them at some point. They leave them for gym, they leave them for art and music, or at least that's a normal routine. Exactly how that will work out, we're still working on that. They clearly leave them and can leave them as far as any personal needs at any time that that's important. Those are the kinds of ways in which it gets worked out, and we're walking the kids across that esplanade now in bad weather, so this is actually less of a hike for kids than what they're doing now as far as the cold, rain, and so forth, which is an issue I've heard people talk about. That's just a quick outline.
Thank you, yeah. When they use the water bubbler, where do they put the wastewater? If they don't drink it, or the science teacher wants to
fill it? It's usually, we keep a bucket.
Where's the closest bathroom to the portables inside that wing?
Which one?
Where, in other words, where would they be have to proceed to?
At the middle, so you want to point them there?
Yeah, the door they would enter is here, and the bathrooms are here and here, boys and girls.
It's about how many feet from, say, the last portable? No, the top one.
Yeah, the top one. The door is 160 feet.
Okay, so that makes about 240 to the furthest one down. What is the cost of adding water?
what, you've got to add sewer pipes, various other kinds of...
The existing sewer line runs right underneath those. I know that that wouldn't coincide well with one of the phases, but there isn't, that's, the existing sewer line is right underneath the portables right now.
Well, but the, there's a larger problem, the...
I was just asking what the cost is.
I don't know.
Okay, do the engineers know what the cost of adding water to the portables is?
No, we don't, but I do certainly know from our previous experience that I don't know of a single school project that we've been involved with where there has been water because of the problem, that it's too expensive. And plus the fact, the expense is not just in getting the water service to, and the sanitary from the portable. Additionally, there are major issues of freeze-up with plumbing in these portables, because it means that you need to provide a totally insulated underbody and skirt to the trailer, and where these are not on any kind of permanent foundations, it's really quite difficult to do without a lot of expense. We certainly can, I think, provide from the portable manufacturer some estimates on putting water and sanitary into those if you
I just,
have that
as a public concern, so. I think, and you know, like I said, 3 years ago, I went through, 4 years ago, I don't remember when the portables were put in. Subsequent to that time, the issue is that students don't get hands-on science, for instance, because they can't use, there are no water facilities in the classrooms. I won't carry on. I just think that's a real concern for a two-year period, not to have any water source at all other than a bubbler. And then you throw it in the pail when you're done.
Excuse me, Mr. Edsel. Sure. Not to interrupt, but I think it would be appropriate at this time if Ms. Goldman would like to discuss the scheduling of classes and how that, I mean, by class 5th through 8th, who goes where and how all of that's sorted out over the two-year phases.
At the present time, we have a group of about 15 people, depending on exactly what issue we're talking about, meeting on, they've been meeting weekly for the last month on a transition team. Part of that is necessitated by the fact that we have to totally pack up both buildings, the major part of the middle school and all of Pond Cove, in order to prepare for asbestos removal this summer. And there's a great deal of planning and logistics that has to go along with that. In addition, of course, we are talking about where we are going to be putting students. For, if you want to have a quick overview of this, it means we understand from our current count at kindergarten that we should have two rooms available in the kindergarten wing, one which is currently used as a kindergarten classroom, one which is used as sort of a gym space, but it is a classroom space. We will be converting those probably to first grade. These are some, there, for a variety of reasons, some of these, exactly what grade will be in, exactly what space still needs to be refined, but that is our current thinking. We have also looked at the possibility of other classroom spaces at the high school in order to avoid as much as possible the kinds of concerns you're raising about the use of portables. They're not ideal. On the other hand, the proximity to the main building and shared classes and specials and so forth makes it attractive for us so that we can continue to offer regular programs. That, in all likelihood, we will not be using more space at the high school, but there is a possibility which we're still investigating as to the use of one room. It means reconfiguring something, so that's something that we are trying to pin down. As far as the phasing for next year, we will not be putting any classes in the Lunt building at the start of the year. That will be emptied out totally so that the project work can go as forward as fast as possible. In that particular part of the building, the first grade will stay right where it is. That is the so-called first grade wing. I think you know which one I mean. And we will be using the what is now the 4th grade wing for 3rd grade, or a combination of 2nd or 3rd. That again is, there are some particular reasons, and we are looking at the use of portables without water because some of our students may have some needs that require us to be sensitive to those issues for a variety of reasons. So we'll be assigning specific classes with that in mind. And the but between the portables and the 4th grade wing, we will be housing the 2nd and 3rd grades. We have looked at the availability of sharing rooms, or not sharing, but I mean reconfiguring some of the rooms at the middle school. So we have decided that by putting two of the portables on the middle school wing, we will be able to house a fourth grade totally in the middle school. This will cut down on the traffic or any possible shared services that we need in order to continue fourth grade classes such as gym, for instance, and they would also be able to use the middle school cafeteria. One of the concerns we have is to eliminate as much as possible any need for the students to go from one building to the other. Quite clearly, we want to keep that staging area free of any pedestrian traffic, although there may be some use, but that reshuffling the grades a little bit will concentrate and make it much smoother for us.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Please continue, Mr. Edsel.
On the south side of the, or at the bus entrance, that the plaza out front, which is, appears to be very attractive, there's one sort of unidentified little island there. It's actually the one closest to the parent drop-off. The parent drop-off.
This side here?
Right.
And what's the question?
It's not labeled on the plan. Maybe it's just the case that it hasn't been labeled yet. It doesn't say whether it's a raised bed or...
There's only three raised islands, as noted on the L-100. That's just a flat panel of grass.
As is the one across. You're right. It doesn't say lawn, but it's just a flat panel of lawn.
Fine. I think that the addition of the esplanade trees adds a great character to the approach to the school, and I appreciate that addition. Yes, I have a question of the landscape architect. I don't even know what a Turkish filbert is, but there seems to be an issue with did I say that right?
Yes.
Okay. It appears to have like a 20-foot diameter, a mature growth, and it's in a 5-foot wide esplanade to be trimmed at 6 feet. Does that pose a problem with traffic coming in on the right-hand lane? I know that sounds like a stupid question.
Well, no, it's not. It's a tree relatively new to me, too. But it is a tree that's on the tree warden's recommended list of street trees.
Yeah, I assume that he was the one that recommended those.
It was on his list, and we discussed it with him, and I was a little bit concerned about some of the other characteristics of it, one of which is the branching habit, which is pretty low, so that we asked whether or not it's appropriate with that kind of a tree in its form to prune the branches up so that you start off with a canopy of a reasonable height rather than fighting it for years. And it's appropriate to prune them up at least 6 feet, if not more, when they're planted. And it's a wonderful street tree. It's highly recommended, and it's new. Well, new. Not a lot of people use it, so it's something different than another maple or another, honey locust or something like that. And it seems very appropriate.
Mm-hmm. It just seemed to be the only place in the plan where the drip edge, or whatever the perimeter of the tree, came out into what will be probably the most heavily trafficked traffic lane. You don't foresee that as a problem.
Maybe I'm misunderstanding your question. You're talking about the drip line, the drip edge, and the width of the tree?
At maturity, it appears to come out into the travel lane, and at 6 feet, there aren't a lot of cars or trucks that go under a six-foot limb.
If it starts out at 6 feet, when it's an 18-foot high tree, everything just keeps going up and getting larger, and as the crown fills out, if there are any offending branches, they can be pruned, but everything just grows up and out, and that's not going to be a problem.
That's one I won't continue to worry about.
Okay.
My next question had to do with explaining L-103, but actually you've done a pretty good job of the phasing. One question I had with the Pond Cove school itself seems to have a fairly short drop-off loop, and I don't know the distance of that. In front of the Pond Cove, it appears that that's what I'm looking at L104. Actually, it doesn't matter. I guess 103 is all.
Yeah, it shows the same on either one.
Approximately how many cars will that, and buses will that hold at any one time during a drop-off period?
There should be no buses coming in that way.
Sorry.
Only cars.
All from day one, in other words, the buses will...
Buses will be coming in here from day one, and kids will go this way or this way.
As for how many cars it will hold, only a very few, three maybe. And it's not a great condition. It's just the best that we have for a short period of time.
Okay. Note on the plan seemed to indicate a new CMP riser pole on the front lawn of maybe that's what's there now. I really don't know.
Where?
At the front lawn of the old high school, the 1930s building, I think it's called. Sorry, I don't have it marked as to be on the electrical detail.
Is that where we're showing our new service to be coming in? Or up on the main end?
It appears so. The underground power runs from there to the transformer that I questioned.
Yeah.
The splicing station. My question, number one, what is a CMP riser pole? Is that another?
Are you talking this pole?
Yes.
It's not shown on this.
That's relocated to just inside the new walkway.
Right. The existing service entrance pole is across the street. And this pole here that has to be relocated, that's a guy pole.
Mm-hmm.
But the riser pole takes the power overhead across the road and then drops down and goes underground from there.
Okay. I think that's what's in that corner anyway, so it's not really a different function, it's just...
No, it's just relocated.
Okay.
It's same, you're right, it's the same function.
Are splice boxes an electrical component that needs to be... is that another issue of safety? In other words, I don't see those on the school ground now. There's one just down over the hill from that. There's another one, the splice box, just past the portables on the west side.
Actually, there are three now. There's one at the loop.
Mm-hmm. Right there.
At the bend. Then there's another one. It's been relocated from here over to this area. Then another one down at the end. Those are requirements of CMP, just to pull wires. Electricians don't like to pull a long distance. So it's an access issue.
I realize that so are transformers, but is it a safety issue for having children?
I think the answer to the question is it's underground.
It's underground?
Oh, yes.
That's fine.
Yeah, from the pole, everything's
Unless the kids start digging them up, we won't worry about it. Just a comment, and I realize it's not really a part of this project, although it shows on the plan. It has to do with the handicapped access. I might suggest taking a look at handicapped access to the tennis courts. Might take a look at running that handicapped access from the new student parking lot. I think the change in elevation is about the same as from the lower area, but it may be just to...
It's possible. We designed it so that at a future time, under hopefully a new budget, that could be expanded or extended on down to the...
It just, where it's located now does not seem to make a lot of sense to come from that access road straight up over a bank. Maybe it's just in there because that is a requirement of accessing.
Are you referring to the access that's shown on coming from the high school access drive, do you mean?
Yes.
Yeah. That's totally beyond our scope. That was something between the town and your town engineer, consulting engineer.
Okay. The fire chief recommends incorporating into the plans three items, and I think they're all worthy items. They're from page two of the planner's memo. Service delivery drive leads to the fire lane west of the elementary school should allow no parking. I don't see any parking there now, so I assume that that's not anything that would be objectionable, that the applicant would mind.
No, that's right. There's no parking now as proposed for the ultimate condition. And I discussed this with Chief McGoldrick and as well as some of the other issues you're about to get to. And they're all resolved. What we're going to do is provide the no parking signs right from day one. So even during construction, it's clear that there's no parking allowed there.
Okay. There's no problem running the fire lane east of the school, down to the curved sidewalk, walkway?
Nope, that, it continues that way today, and it was just the fact, I believe, that there was a note not on the other side of that little circle, which is just a flush.
Some little round thing.
It's just a brick pattern in the pavement, so they can drive right through there now. They always could, and they will be able to.
Good, the public comment about access, that does make that final link of a walkway, a public walkway. The plan shows a 4-foot gate, which I assume would be open at all time for public access on that side of the building. Is there any objection on the part of the applicant to include in the plan the Public Works Director's request for a dumpster versus using a pickup truck? Is that a budgetary item more?
It's really, it's an administrative decision at this point. The decision was made, we had proposed one before, and their apparent practice currently is to use their truck, and they just kind of continue to use that.
Well, I feel like taking a break here, where I do have some other questions, but certainly open it to board members.
If you would like to continue.
No, but. Want to reorganize?
Thank you. And does any of the other board members have any questions or comments?
Just one quick one. The subject of encroachments, I guess, has to be addressed at some point in time, property lines and the property adjacent to the new driveway. I'm not even sure who to address the question to.
Well, I, speaking, excuse me, Mr. Manager, from the chair's position, the issue has been raised on a couple of occasions, and it's been referred to us by the applicant's representatives that this was an issue that was a town issue and not a school department or a project issue as such. The planning board simply would like to have, if we're approving a site plan application, we would like to have either an easement description, either an easement shown on the drawings that identifies that as an encroachment, or a hatch of that area that simply identifies it as an area of apparent encroachment, so that there is no public record, either in town hall or somehow at the registry of deeds, that would in any way, through this approval, indicate to the abutters that the land which is currently being used as their backyards, and may have been so for some time, is in any way approved to continue as such as part of the approval of this project. For anyone who's seen the recent reevaluations of town properties, I believe town single-family home lots in this area is roughly $1,000 a square foot. So we're not talking about a small change in terms of the total value of the lands that are currently being used by those abutters. But the chair will recognize the town manager, and if the town manager could just simply describe or review your note to us and describe the situation.
Yes, Mr. Chairman, I agree with your view that the town would not want anything in this record to indicate that we permanently, in any fashion, do allow those encroachments. We do allow them within the framework of the term of sufferance, which is, in essence, the legal term is that we know they're there, we tolerate them, we put up with them, but we're not at all responsible with it. The town has run into this on a number of occasions in a number of different sites. And our general practice has been, as long as it does not interfere with the operation of the town's uses on its property, we do allow it to continue by sufferance.
Is there any way, is there any particular vehicle that the town has to use, or notification or other use of the property, that would indicate to the abutters that they do not rightfully have use of that property, so that there isn't, I don't know what the legal term would be, but after 21 years that land would revert to those abutters?
I think you're speaking of adverse possession.
Yes, one of my favorite subjects.
Yeah. The town does not routinely send out notes to all its abutters indicating that we maintain our rights.
Would the town object to a note on the drawing identifying those areas, and a note that refers to those as areas of apparent encroachment?
I believe the plan already does indicate that.
Okay. Ms. Parkhurst? Thank you.
Ms.
Any other?
I guess the only other thing, I just clearly don't remember, there was an issue about curbing, and Public Works not wanting granite curbing. I think it was on the islands.
I believe it was. Yeah, the issue is that they don't want curbing, period, whether it's granite or otherwise. We're talking about the two islands in the large parking lot.
That was the comment.
Okay, so there will be no curbing at all?
Well, if no curbing, no islands. They wouldn't survive without curbing. So it's either curbing with islands with curbing, granite, because asphalt wouldn't survive either, or no islands. They just would never make it. So we'd like to include it as part of the planting design, but it comes with that issue of plowing around them.
That's it for me.
Mr. Wilcox?
With regard to the islands with the trees, I think they're a valuable addition to what would otherwise be a fairly bleak, empty parking lot, and if it takes granite curbs to protect them, so be it, as far as I can tell.
Any other comments regarding the plans? Mark? No other questions? Roy? Steve, would you care to continue?
Just a couple others. What's the applicant proposing for lighting the main entrance sign? The plan at this, I didn't see a detail. What type of lighting are you proposing?
They're small, like up-mounted floodlights that shine up into the sign from being ground-mounted lights. And they are 70-watt metal halide lights with little kind of shut-off, screen around them or frame around them that limits where the light goes. And they got polycarbonate lenses to keep them in good shape for quite a while. Harder to break.
Okay. This next question deals with number 10 in T.Y. Lynn's comments. I think that it is important. I realize most of those comments from the town engineer are technical, and I don't care to go through all of those unless there's something that I pick up that's less technical than I can understand. But it does deal with the emergency access exits. Have you reviewed with the code enforcement officer the issue? I mean, we're talking, for instance, that the Scott Dyer roadside doors in the Little Pond Cove side, and we said, well, that's not going to be an entrance door, so we don't need a walkway and that type, and improvements won't have to be done, but that is an exit, and it's a good point.
Yes, we've talked to both Ernie McVane and Chief McGoldrick about the exiting from the entire facility.
Okay.
And the issue on maintaining access to those doors is that it is a school plowing and maintenance issue, and they are aware of the fact that those exits must be kept clear year-round.
Approximately, how many similar situations in the entire building are that they're not entrance and exits, they're just strictly emergency exit doors, other than that one at that end? Do you know?
I think there's about five locations.
Okay.
Yeah. Basically, there's an exit out of this. This is the Pond Cove School here.
Mm-hmm.
There's an emergency egress out of this library here. There's an emergency egress for the first graders out here. There's an emergency egress out here from the 7th and 8th grade wing. There's an emergency egress out of the art room here. There's an emergency egress into this courtyard.
So four out of six of them face the west-northwest from a winter. But you're saying that's not a school administrative maintenance issue. Connie? Sure, if you could, please, just so it's part of the record.
Okay.
We have a longstanding understanding with the Public Works to do major plowing around schools and so forth. What we've discovered in the last two winters is that at the time when they're the busiest, we also have a heavy need to get in, use the buildings, and clear out. So we have, this year, added on a rental basis, that is a contract basis, with an independent operator, small plow truck, and that's how we are managing to keep all of those fire exits and entrances useful, not only for the main walkways people going in, but also the fire. And we think we have it down pretty well at this point. It does add to our school budget, but at least it makes sure that those things are taken care of. When we were trying to rely on a combination of our own shovel power and the small snow blowers and the Public Works when they could finish their main road work, we were having difficulties getting the fire lanes clear, so we think we have it under control now.
Thank you.
Thanks. That's it.
That's it. Thank you. No other comments from the board members? I think the board has hit upon at least most of the issues raised in Maureen's memo. I guess we have Mr. Bray here, so we'll take advantage of his presence and again ask that if Mr. Bray could please go through the traffic circulation patterns by user type on the vehicular or automobile access road. A particular concern, I guess what I would like to hear is a description of the circulation for those parking lots nearest the building, as well as any comments regarding the size of the large lot across the access road and one access and egress from that lot.
I think, Mr. Chairman, it would be appropriate for Dennis probably to go through the actual usage of the different lots. I've looked at the lot more from just the design standpoint of whether it meets, you know, typical engineering design for a parking lot layout. I wasn't as concerned with the actual usage of the parking lots, other than I did have an obvious concern for being sure that there was adequate room for vehicles queued around the drop-off area for the parents. And I have looked at that, and I've also looked at the entrance design. In fact, I assisted Dennis in that actual design. I think it may be more appropriate for Dennis to review the actual usage of the lots.
Okay, thank you. Dennis is here. Dennis, would you please, I'm looking at drawing L100, and I'm looking in the areas of a lot labeled 14 and 13, for example. There are some very sharp turning radiuses coming out of those lots, very wide a mouth because of that, and there seems to be an unprotected space right at what would be a very busy and critical corner there, that there's a car exposed to the turning movements on that corner. I know exactly how it ended up this way. It's a combination of existing buildings and the, I mean, the proposed building and the alignment of the road, but that is all two-way circulation in there. Would you please describe who's going to be using that lot?
It's two-way circulation because it's designed, we want cars to be able to get in and out either direction or out either direction from inside the parking lot, but we're encouraging cars only to be entering the parking lot and not entering the parking lot from this entrance, entering it only from this side. So we're limiting cars coming in from the main road to this entrance here. It's close. There's plenty of room, theoretically, for a car to back up and drive out. If one, I would guess, would want to, from this edge, probably want to go right out this way rather than out this way. But they could go either way. If one were to want to go out, back up, and drive in this direction and go out, back straight up for more than the car length and still not be in the lane, technically, however, yes, they can drive right into there if they wanted to.
Is that all visitor parking in there, or is that staff parking?
That's staff and visitor parking.
Okay. One could go past, well, those are parking numbers now. I finally picked it up. One could go from that area and drive back toward the drop-off loop. Is that not correct, and get reincorporated in the drop-off loop?
This way.
Or turn right and head back out the access road?
This way, that's correct.
During either the last meeting or during the site walk, there was some discussion about aligning the, I believe it was aligning the curb from the drop-off area into the parking lot where it's labeled, where the 31 spaces are located. And there was a directional issue there. Do you recall that discussion?
Yes, I do, and we did respond to that on this plan. We have, as before, you may recall, the arc of this line just continued on and blended into the arc around the circle. What we have done this time is to continue the arc of the circle as the stronger element, mm-hmm. and wrapping it around, providing the 24-foot wide access into the parking lot. And there's a sign here saying, through traffic, straight.
Okay. I would like to add, in terms of the islands within the parking lot opposite the access road, that given the length of that parking lot, I don't think it's unusual, or I appreciate the Public Works Director's concern, but we have similar situations behind Town Hall that have been maintained, as far as I know, very successfully, and the distance between these two islands and the ones at Town Hall are considerably greater. If it weren't for the tremendous short need of parking spaces, I would suggest that we have two more opposite the entrance drive, but I'm not going to force that issue. One concern that I do have, however, is that this is a very large parking lot with one entrance and one exit all at one point, and the traffic will be circulating either clockwise, counterclockwise, but in any number of directions. Either exiting or entering that parking lot, you show a small island with a 4-foot radius. If cars are exiting and entering at the same time, making left and right turn maneuvers against each other, so to speak, for anyone to enter that lot, it forces a car into the opposing lane to make a right-hand turn. I think realistically what needs to be done is that the first two parking spaces on each side of that access drive need to be used to incorporate a longer turning radius. It would seem to me that a 15-foot turning radius would be a minimum turning radius because of the restricted single entrance.
Right, that's a perfectly reasonable way to approach that. An alternative, or the fact what this represents is not a 4-foot or an 8-foot turning radius, but a 4-foot radius somewhere within that 15 or 25-foot turning radius, whereas I mean this car has lots of room to maneuver in either direction around those points. So I think from a safety perspective, I'm not sure if it's that bad. However, I have no problem in making that wider, losing two parking spaces if the board isn't going to mind losing two more parking places. We're at 221. At this point, we're at 224. We lost two with the islands. Unless the school department has a concern with that, I don't think it's going to hurt too much losing two more.
I would ask the board if the board has an opinion. I think, in essence, the parking spaces are lost either for snow storage, for maneuvering, for sight lines and safety. I think it would be better to have those two spaces for safety purposes than for incidental parking.
That was part of a question that I had. If Bob Malley had given an estimate of how many spaces are lost in the wintertime, I realize it has to do with how much snow we get, but every year we lose parking spaces to snow storage. Has he taken a look at it? We have quite a configuration there where it looks like we'll lose quite a bit of, or can lose. I'm not sure whether we lose two more to this when we're looking at wintertime snow storages.
We did look at that carefully with him. We went through the entire design, and he was just kind of imagining himself driving through, plowing everything, where's all the snow going to go? And we, in his estimation, we have plenty of snow storage, more than most around the different parking areas.
There were, continuing with the town planner's memo, under the discussion of lighting, there was a comment regarding lighting proposed in front of the entrances of the building. The lighting along the access drive in some places is 10 feet. Has a 10-foot mounting height, as I understand, to accommodate concerns about lighting impacts on the adjacent properties. Similar, not a similar concern, but a concern is raised with the appropriateness of the pole height in an area that's predominantly pedestrian, with a suggestion that perhaps as low as 10 feet. I guess I would, the issue of a 10-foot pole is an issue in terms of a middle school environment. That's about the height of a backstop, and it's just something that kids would love to jump up and slap with their hands if they could. I would have a concern about the maintenance exposure on a pole that's that short. At the same time, I have a concern about a 20-foot pole in a pedestrian space. Is there any middle ground that we can meet that would be both appropriate in terms of aesthetics and scale as well as vandalism?
I would like to say that's where we are, but maybe you won't agree. We looked hard after the first set of comments about that issue and looked how we can we really pull down the size of those lights in that front entrance area and still make it work. And we tried all bollards, and we tried 10-foot poles and bollards and all 10-foot poles. And it just kept turning out to be lots and lots of poles. Because of the configuration of the walks, we needed to get enough lighting here and there. And there were just too many shadow opportunities and too many places where we needed to get the foot candle level up. And it just started to look more like a, you know, forest out there without treetops than a plaza. So, and we didn't want that. We didn't want to have lots of opportunities for kids to be swinging on the lights and tethering themselves around and around. So we ended up saying, well, 20-foot lights, they aren't 10-foot poles, but they certainly aren't 30s or 40s. And they're not that unfriendly, I don't think. And I think it's sensible, given those trade-offs that we have to make.
What is the height of the building at the front entrance? Just to give us a sense of scale of a 20-foot pole to the building.
This elevation over here is 26 feet from the first floor to the top.
To the very top, and how about to the, is that a parapet in the, is that, yeah, what is that line? 24 feet. How about 16? Have you looked at 16?
We did not look at 16. I'm not being an electrical engineer, I can't tell you how much you start to lose, but I know it's not linear when you come down in elevation for any given light intensity. We didn't look at that.
How in the, again, out on the access drive in terms of the 10-foot poles, do you have an issue with the vandalism on that mounting height, for that mounting height?
Not really. I don't think the intensity of use there is going to be anything like in the front of the school. And we worked hard trying to get lights that would, A, provide the kind of light that we need along any kind of a walk or drive, but B, not spill lots of light into the neighborhood yards, and that was our real prime driving force there. And that's the light fixture that worked.
Okay. There's a question of lighting of the access road from the high school, now that that would be used for bike traffic. It's my understanding there is none. I raise it in concern for what I feel is a safety issue around the back of the high school on that inside corner as you head down during, as I've brought up in the past, there are two issues there. When it's dark out, there's a silhouette effect during soccer games where you just can't see anything because there's no foreground lighting. Similar situation could happen here. Admittedly, this is for bus traffic, but there are times during the late afternoon when buses would be arriving during winter hours where it would be a need for some additional lighting, I believe.
We have been trying to understand the limits of our work on this project for, you know, throughout the process, and there's lots of things that we've had to do beyond what we consider the scope of the middle and elementary schools, and I think this is a piece of that, in that I know that we've had to redesign and widen this road here as part of our bus accessing. We are now coming through the high school, and we are now providing two-way traffic through here. And we do recognize that we had a dangerous or potentially dangerous condition, and
although this plan doesn't reflect it, the Public Works is going to move this building back for us. And we had to widen this pavement 4 feet or so, tapering down to zero, which you might think drives our work all the way down here, but simply we're just putting a wedge of pavement along that edge and doing some minor grading to make that a safer passage. And we have not considered lighting that way between the two schools because the bus traffic will be using it and they will be providing their own lights. There's lighting from Public Works, there's lighting from the high school parking area, which will now be the bus parking area, and feel that that's sufficient.
There is, I'm not going to harp on the point, but there is considerable community evening traffic on the school campus, and there are several very dark spots that are probably outside the purview of this review, but the high school site has been tied in with this site now that the parking lot, the dominoes have fallen, and those issues are just up for offering as requiring looking at the lighting. I don't have enough personal experience on that drive in the evening to know whether or not, if it's used for buses, whether lighting is required or not. I will leave that up to the applicant and the consultant's best judgment. There is a question regarding buffering. I think we've discussed the issue around the bus parking lot. Moving to the access drive once again, I don't know that it's a planning board's purview to select tree species. However, I must admit that I'm not familiar with a Turkish filbert. And could you describe the mature height? Let me make the point first. The point is that this is a large school campus with large buildings, with large open spaces. And with a minimum amount of money spent, it would seem appropriate that we have large street trees, large shade tree scale trees, for one, to minimize environmental impacts, to maximize shade, and to be consistent with the overall scale of the complex. Is this, in fact, a tree that is of significant specimen size, such as a sugar maple or other larger tree, or is it more of an ornamental large crab apple shape?
It's, as I recall, if I recall correctly, and I believe it's about 60 feet high and about 30 feet wide, and it's sort of pyramidal shape. It's kind of an architectural form tree rather than a loose open canopy. The lower branches do spread out, and that's why we have recommended that they be pruned up at planting time. But it's relatively pyramidal, and I will check for you to make sure, but I believe it's around 60 feet high and 30 feet wide, 30 to 40 feet wide. 50 feet high? 50 feet high.
You're a registered landscape architect. You're the consultant's, you're the applicant's consultant on the project. We have a tree warden in town that doesn't agree with every landscape architect's point of view. As one board member, I would not have any problem with your reviewing the tree list, discussing it with the tree warden, and coming up with a mutually agreeable specimen of tree along the driveway and within the parking lot that is of street tree, shade tree quality, that has year-round interest, fall color, and so forth, to the extent possible. Admittedly, oak trees don't have a lot in some cases in fall color, other cases do. But I haven't done the research on the tree yet, but I would just want to be sure that if you don't feel comfortable with this selection, I know that the tree warden, and I shouldn't say this since he's not here to defend himself, but has expressed concern in the past about locations within which trees will survive, and has been very conservative, and rightfully so as an arborist, about the tree specimen and the size of esplanade and adjacency to roads. I've lived in major cities, and I know that trees can do quite well when put into other than ideal conditions. So I don't have any hesitancy about suggesting trees that are of larger scale, that are more traditional trees that might have other varieties of leaves and more familiar with students. I particularly would like to see larger trees in the parking lot, particularly since we only have two islands. Crab apples there are just not going to, even a mature apple, although it's not, I mean a regular apple, although the fruit wouldn't be appropriate, it would be of scale perhaps better. The other question that has come up is with respect to buffering along the, or planting along the inside edge of the access road, that we have a row of trees now lining up along the outside edge, as far as I can see.
Mm-hmm. Yes, and your question in relation to this inside edge?
Yes, there's no planting between shade tree planting on the inside island of on the access road to provide shade to the cars that are parked or to break up the expansive pavement of the area adjacent to the school. It would seem that at least as a minimum those two end islands and perhaps the island in the middle of the parking lot would be locations that would be appropriate to have additional tree, street tree planting.
And here?
That's correct.
Yeah.
I realize there's an issue of mortar and books and budget that has to be addressed, and I'm very sensitive to that issue. But there's an overall issue of environmental impact of the school and the message that we put to our children in terms of the overall quality and aesthetics of a school ground. I think we've come a long way in 20 years, but have a little farther to go in some cases. Would you please review, at least so I'm not confused, and there may be some other confusion, there's an issue of the town center drainage plan that proposes to fill the ditch that runs down the high school access road. For the record, that ditch will not be touched during, other than to have a culvert installed underneath the access road to the high school student parking lot, that ditch will not be altered.
For our project, for what we need to do to make our storm system work, that's mostly correct. We need to do two things to that ditch. One is, as you just said, cover it with and culvert it to get into the parking. And the other is to, although we discussed, we have a detention basin designed over here, which takes the majority of the water from most of the paved areas and detains it here. We still have water going down in this portion of the site where we had proposed before, as you see in your other plans. That swale, there's an outlet, a system that outlets to that swale, which still goes down into that ditch, and we need to at least provide some stabilization fabric and seed to maintain that that ditch and keep it in check to the point from our discharge of our swale to the point of the culvert underneath the access to the tennis court. That's the other area that we're proposing to alter.
Okay.
Mr. Chairman?
Yes,
it is related to that question. That indicated a swale between the baseball field and what's the lacrosse field right there. Originally, that was going to be underground piping. Are you telling me now that is
It's
above ground swale drainage?
Well, it's
our plans don't reflect.
On L101,
mm-hmm.
You can see that we have a pipe going down to a point past the part of the baseball field, and then it opens up, it daylights into
okay.
A swale.
Okay.
And that riprap swale will go down to the ditch.
Okay. And that is all of the stormwater drainage from the east side of this section of the campus, is that correct? Goes to that location?
Jerry could better answer if you want to get into more detail
about
that.
Yeah,
that's right.
Catch basins that I mentioned, right.
Most of the pavement from the roof drains and the pavements are going to the silt sedimentation trap, the oil grit separator, and then to the detention basin.
Mm-hmm.
Mostly grass-related drainage from around the rest of the campus with a little bit of pavement, bus garage, bus turnaround, et cetera, will be going down that swale into the ditch.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Edsel. Following up with that question, where does the detention basin outlet?
It outlets to an existing swale which currently flows from the wetland. And it flows around kind of an arcing form and then right out. I'm not sure exactly where it goes from this point, but it goes to that ditch and then ultimately to the culvert underneath the road right at the edge of the site.
We don't have that design in front of us, so I'll ask the question. Is there adequate, or are you anticipating ditch construction to direct that water around the that lower field area?
I believe we still need to do that final calculation, but I don't believe we will need to do any additional ditch protection other than immediately out of the proposed detention basin itself. There will be some riprap there.
There is existing some of the riprap, stone riprap, about where the 55-foot contour starts. If you can see it right to the north of the tennis courts, and it runs parallel to the end of the tennis courts now.
Okay, I see. I had the detention basin closer to the wetland.
Yeah.
Okay. I guess I would like to pick up on one earlier comment that was raised by the public, and that's the issue of the town center plan. As a member of the town center committee, I can only say that this the applicant has been in the process of planning this project for many, many months. And economically and academically for much longer than that. And although I haven't seen all of the iterations and studies, I'm not sure I would have designed it the same way. I'm not sure the applicant would have designed it the same way 1 year apart. This is the solution that the applicant has brought to us with the monies that have been allotted to the project that the voters approved. As a planning board, we are pretty much fixed in terms of that program, and we're looking to the life safety issues that deal with that issue, that we've left it up to the administration and the building committee, again, represented by both professional and town volunteers. So to the extent that we're able to improve impact or bring light to some of our concerns, we've done so. I would like to reinforce that there is pedestrian access down the east side of the building, and it is our understanding that will remain open and that pedestrian access will be available into the school from the Scott Dyer Road side in through the courtyard into the two opposing entrances, and then from the north of Scott Dyer Road along the sidewalk along the entrance drive. Yes, Mr. Edsel.
Mr. Chairman, I'd just like to add that the comment made by the public. One of the first meetings we had, I think maybe even a year ago now, my question when we first looked at the plans was why are we proposing this spread out one level plan that covers more and more of the site? Why don't we build up? The answer to that at that time was it's more expensive to go up than to go out. I didn't necessarily like that answer, but that was the answer that was given, and I assume that it still stands, that it's more economic to spread out the plan, thus using more of the site for building and improvements.
One issue that has not been raised, I believe, tonight is the issue of there are actually one that was and one which isn't. The one that was the issue of parking along Scott Dyer. Again, boards work in mysterious ways, and we are faced with something that the zoning board has already pretty much given us, and now I understand the town council really has purview over anyway. As one board member, I would encourage, as the town manager has already described, a cooperation during construction. I have two children in the middle school, and on the best of days, it's really quite a chore getting in and out of that site. Under a construction situation, people, I hope, will either give up and not try to drop their kids off. Otherwise, I think there's an awful lot of asphalt going in front of the school that can be used perfectly well during construction for drop-off areas if it's policed and designated. I would also think that perhaps, depending upon the outcome of the study of Scott Dyer Road and future sidewalk improvements, that there may be areas on the school side of Scott Dyer Road rather than on the opposite side of Scott Dyer Road that could be used for parallel parking if there are areas of meshing and so forth. But the greater issue there is the fact that the planning board has raised concerns about sidewalk improvements and access along Scott Dyer Road. Through the manager's correspondence, we're informed that that issue is really, there are no funds available today, that there will be funds available through grants. And that, as a board, I would just ask that if anyone would like to discuss the issue of how the board has assurances that those sidewalk improvements, which are necessary along the front of the school, will be, how our concerns will be made part of the record as terms of site plan approval on this project.
Mr. Chairman, I would just recommend that we follow the town manager's lead with a note indicating the sidewalk is to be replaced with curbing, is to be replaced with curbing to be installed. Sidewalk detail should require subsequent planning board permit. I think it revolves around that issue.
Since we have
a requirement to come back to
the luxury of having the town manager here, Mike, is it necessary? Is it our understanding then that the approval of this project we can tie a future review of the sidewalk, something which might not necessarily otherwise come before the planning board?
I think what I said is whether or not you can or not, I would encourage you to do that.
Okay. Oh, well, we'll certainly do so.
Well said.
I don't know who will be here. But
thank you. How'd you say that again? Whether you can or not.
All right. Peter, I see you're finally here.
Yes, sir.
Welcome. Do you have any further comments?
None at all.
Okay, thank you. With that, does the applicant have any, Mark?
I have a couple of comments or questions which I was wondering if you might address. The first would revolve around the present middle school creative playground area. Where would members of the public park in the future to utilize that space in evenings and on weekends? They have to go all the way to the furthest south parking lot because all the other ones are sort of designated for staff or whatnot?
These parking lots here.
That one right there. Okay. I have two other questions in regard to the slope which goes from the large south parking lot down to the playing fields. Will there be designated access points for the students to go down that slope, improvements to it?
And from which location?
Well, from wherever. Right now there appears to be a sidewalk off of the southeast that terminates at the southeast corner. Mm-hmm. Will there actually be a path down the slope there, or steps, or I mean,
no.
It's a
no. If kids react the way my mind do, I think they'll be just spilling off all the way along this walk in every direction, and there will probably not be one place that would get overly abused. Mm-hmm. In fact, I don't think they'll make it even quite down that far.
Okay. Edge between the south parking lot itself and the slope. Does there need to be, or has any guardrail or protection been contemplated for, or are there wheel stops, or?
There's a curb there.
There's a curb.
And that's all that we're proposing.
And that's sufficient for?
It's a curb and a 4-on-1 slope, and I believe if you want to rely on DOT standards for that kind of stuff, and Bill, correct me if I'm wrong, that a 4-on-1 slope is sufficient not to require a guardrail.
Thank you.
Mr. Chairman?
Yes, Mr. Carlson.
Good question. Looking at L-102, the traffic pattern with this parking lot with one entrance kind of truthful to being new to the board kind of scares me. Was angled parking ever considered to promote counterclockwise entry and out, such as we find in many parking garages in the town? I think pound of Portland, even, you come in, you have to go right because the angles are so set up.
Mm-hmm.
But I can visualize coming into this entrance here, going left, going right, going around, cars parking out, backing into each other while there's two-way traffic between them. Was angle parking considered at all? Is there a drawback to that?
The only drawback is the number of spaces you can fit in any given area. It's a little bit fewer spaces. You don't need as well with depends on the angle you use. You don't need quite as wide a travel lane.
But you understand my counterclockwise
yeah.
rotation mm-hmm. going through the lot.
Yeah, in any direction, but yes, you can angle them so that you can only go one way, which makes sense, and...
I just visualize someone coming into that main entrance and seeing a lot spot on the other side and saying, well, should I go left or go right to get there before somebody else might get there? And if you had to go right, you're in line to get the next spot that's available, really. You just have to keep on going around. And if there's nothing there, you just go back out. I think it might be something for you to consider.
Thank you. I'll just follow up with that on two points. One, first of all, we have a similar situation behind the high school, and I suppose that works in about 90% of the cases. People do follow the one-way routes in any number of creative ways, but I believe at some time we had discussed the location of the entrance drive into that large parking lot. Would it make any sense, or why was the entrance drive not moved farther northwest so that you came directly into the parking lot, could circulate around in one direction pretty much, and then head out?
That design was considered, and it was part of an earlier consideration where I wanted to have parking access on this end and on this end. Maybe you could call it either way. I didn't feel it was better to have cars come in on just one end of a very long parking lot, and if they could come out this way, that would be great. And I had it designed early on in the concepts to weave right into this, but just quickly became real congested in here, and it seemed best to have move it back. And we went back and forth with one or two and one or two, and for a variety of reasons in layout and grading, this settled in to be the one that we chose. There's no magic to it, it's just that's where we ended up and its location in the parking lot.
Thank you. Any other comments? We're a little behind schedule, but I don't see that as an issue since we primarily the main item on the agenda. We have a number of items that have been discussed tonight. Some are comments, some are questions, some are requests, I suppose. In addition, we have a number of items which have been raised in the planner's memo, or attached to the planner's memo, specifically the engineer's issues, which I think are best left between the applicant and the engineer. At this point, no other comments. I'd like to ask for a motion. Mr. Wilcock?
I just noticed one thing that I was wondering about, and it is mentioned in the memo. The Jordan Way being used for construction deliveries, the plans currently say scheduled construction deliveries. Could you explain what that means?
Yes. The area proposed for that use, we're calling the minor contractor staging area. And this is to be used mainly when the front of the new building is being constructed. It's all general deliveries, and almost all deliveries throughout the entire project will be coming in Scott Dyer Road. But there will be some deliveries for bricks, et cetera, at this location. It will be after the school buses come and go, or before they come back in the afternoon. And it will be by schedule only, so that they come over here and they say, we have a delivery, and they'll go over and they'll let them in, because this will be a locked gate. So when I say schedule, it means that a few times and as directed and outside of the conflicting time zones for school access. And then in the second phase, as you can see on sheet 1-4, we have taken that fence away, the work is done in that zone, and all of the work is now, well, still in this contractor staging in a large area, and then around the west side of the building.
Thank you. Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Edsel.
Did the fire chief have a chance to review the phasing plans? A couple of reasons they come up as far as the access to the buildings. Fairly complete. But it goes back to the question about temporary. Maybe that was the source of his comment on parking. You have some temporary handicapped access and parking down near the building itself on
down the road to the...
Yeah, I did discuss it with them at length. I went down and sat with them. We went over both phases, both plans, as well as just on the phone recently. And his main concern was that this area here be no parking right from day one. And so we've moved that, the installation of the no parking signs to the first phase of construction rather than allowing it to happen at the end when all the rest of the site work is being completed. So those will be going in right away. That was his main concern here, not this parking. Mm-hmm. He was concerned, and we went through his access during the construction. And in this location, it's going to be a coordination issue that he just said, just make sure the contractor, and this is kind of stuff we can work with our clerk, maintains an access into the center part of the project here, the courtyard, and we will be coordinating that with the contractors. This access is okay, and he wanted to make sure he got some distance in this location. He was happy with around this location, and the way the existing grades and the proposed grades turn out, it looks like we can get a temporary gravel fire lane all the way up to the proposed new parking lot. So he is satisfied with the access throughout the phasing, first phase, second phase, throughout both years of construction.
Okay. Does the applicant have any problem? I think that he had asked that both drop-off circles were designated as fire lanes, not just a straight shot. So I don't know why, but I mean, that's his request.
Well, that's,
do you have any problem with that?
Well, we discussed that one as well, based on planner's memo and his comments through that. And what we have done, and this was fine on this side because only buses are allowed in there anyway, so we have no parking fire lane at the fire lane itself, and he's satisfied with that. On the parent drop-off side, he requested that we have not just no parking fire lane and then no parking this side around here, but say no parking fire lane around the whole thing on both sides. He said that's a little bit more urgent for people. They believe that more than just, you know, don't park this side. So we've done that on our new plans, which will be submitted next week, showing no parking fire lane all the way around, and that was satisfactory to him.
Okay. One more question. The contractor staging area, would you describe briefly what happens in that area?
I will start, and maybe Ellen or Paul wants to jump in. This is the area where he's going to be setting up his trailers, his stockpiles of materials, parking employees, his contractor employees, etc. And he's got that whole space dedicated for that use throughout the entire length of the project. Anything he needs is going to happen in that space, and except, as we said early on, some minor storage in the front during that first phase.
Is there any concern about the proximity of that area to the existing buildings that will be occupied?
In this side? In the courtyard, you mean?
Mm-hmm.
I haven't discussed that specific thing with our clerk. There has been no concerns raised as yet about any of that. There seems to be ample room, and a lot of the construction is going to be happening along this wall. And Ellen, where are some of the parts of, during the first phase, any construction along this edge here?
During the first phase, the major piece of construction while the school is occupied is the C wing down here and the renovation of this wing, which is interior work here. Mm-hmm. The exterior work along here will occur during the summer. One of the reasons to locate the contractor staging area here is that the majority of the new construction flanks this area, and the contractor will have direct access to that area of new construction while school functions will be maintained in the middle school interior, and the contractor access to the area of new construction will not be through any occupied space. So the contractor will have direct access to the area without going through occupied school construction.
Will there be a requirement for fencing or cordoning of that construction area?
Yes. This heavy dotted line indicates a chain link fence.
Chain link, okay.
Here. And around here, we hope in this area here, where it's just facade work, to be able to use a snow fence, not a chain link fence.
Okay, thank you. There are no other comments or questions. I would like to entertain
one last question.
Mr. Parker.
When the portable classrooms are set up on the Pond Cove School, where are the children going to be playing? It seems to be a very diminished playground for the Pond Cove School.
The two active play areas, three active play areas, one is at this playground, which remains active and no impact on that. One is over here, where there's obviously no impact, and then there's just the open play area back here, which will continue to function. We do chew up this space right here next to the building for that first year of construction. We've been through this with the administrators, and everybody believes that this is a reasonable alternative, a reasonable condition.
And for the record, while you're up there, the stockpile is shown in the area of the baseball field. Would you describe, both in terms of school and community use, what happens?
There will be essentially no use of those areas, no real active play use, ball field kind of uses in that area until construction is complete.
Tough left field. Mm-hmm. It's a tough left field.
It is, but I've played on worse. What happens then to the recreational activity that takes place there now? Where is that relocated?
I believe some of it will be relocated to other fields when available, and others just won't happen for that period of time. And we've discussed this quite at length with Sue and the rest of the athletic personnel. And people seem to recognize that this is something we have to live with for the duration of the construction.
Okay.
So they'll stop planning events.
This relocated media center doesn't show on your, maybe I just can't see that far, but.
This is revised from the one you have in front of you.
That's subsequent to this?
Yes.
Okay. So there's no moving of the media center?
That's correct.
Okay.
It has no end walls.
There's no what?
No end walls.
Oh. It's pretty much in place anyway.
Yeah.
Any other comments?
Paul, yes, sir.
Motion?
Do I hear a motion?
Motion for the planning board to consider. Be it ordered that based on the plans and materials submitted and facts presented, the application of the school department for site plan approval of renovation and new construction of the middle and elementary schools be tabled to the regular May 17th, 1994 meeting of the planning board.
Any discussion? Second?
I'll second it for the sake of discussion. Just some sense of how we're doing for a time frame as far as the applicant is concerned.
I think we're doing fine. I think it's only as our anticipation that we'll be able to reach closure over the course of the next month on the project, and we're planning on another resubmittal in anticipation of the May 17th planning board within the next week or so. I think we need to do that. So I guess we certainly are hoping that we will receive approval on May 17th. Our current plans are to release the project for bid on Monday, May 23rd. So the timing is perfect.
I know I went on with lots of questions, but my intent was trying to get as many out as I could.
Yeah, no, I think we were very pleased with the input that we got tonight, and I think it certainly reinforces my feeling that we have a lot of issues here to resolve in terms of wrapping up some of the details, but all the major pieces are in place, and I think we're appreciative of the thoughtful time that you people have given to this and the comments that we've received, and we feel like we're in pretty good shape, and hope you feel so too. Thanks.
I have a second.
A second.
You have a second. Okay. All those in favor of the motion? All opposed? Table till the next regular meeting of the planning board. If there's, before you leave, if there was a lot of items discussed, some major issues, some minor comments, do you feel comfortable with the items that were discussed, that you have a grasp on the issues?
I believe we do. There are just a couple of substantive issues which I guess you want us to look at, i.e. the parking layout, to make sure that this 90-degree layout is appropriate, and to possibly come up with some new trees for the street tree plantings that might get a little bit bigger, be more in scale with the kind of space, and some other minor planting issues. But if there's, I don't see anything, and I haven't heard anything that is going to be a problem next month, unless, and tell me if that's not correct. If you have if I've misunderstood something, to be if we don't do it, it's a deal breaker. I'd like to know about that clearly now so that we can address that and have it ready for our next submission. But it seems to me that we're in agreement, except for some small items.
I didn't hear any deal breaking discussions this evening. I would suggest then that if you could meet with Maureen, and Maureen will have a more detailed list and summary from the meeting notes. Okay. And if there are any questions at that point, she can contact me.
We'll all be meeting with Maureen and Steve Bradstreet on Wednesday to go over all of the submission issues on that detailed level and present to him the storm design and detention, which he hasn't seen yet, and just make sure that he understands it completely so that we can have a smooth next round.
Okay, great. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Let's see. Moving right along. Next item on the agenda is the dead end road standard. We have a recommendation from the town council for amendments to the dead end road standards for the subdivision ordinance. We've discussed these in workshop and made some changes to the wording, as well as gotten definitions from the town attorney. There are two issues tonight. One is to recommend it to the town council, and secondly, to decide whether or not we want to refer it to public hearing. I guess with respect to the public hearing, I just want to mention that it will be going to public hearing when it reaches the council. So with that, if there's anything further more you could like to add. Okay. Any discussion?
I have one question, or actually two questions. I'm looking up as quickly as I can. And it is, I was just seeing if the term access road is defined, and it is. And that's really the only question. Everything else was made a change. When we talked about it at workshop, we had a problem with the word notwithstanding, but it's hard to get rid of that word notwithstanding unless you use the word in spite of. Or
it was put in a context. Any other questions or comments?
Is our minimum road width now 24 feet? I thought it was 22 for some reason.
The minimum width is 20 feet for a local road, 18 feet for emergency access.
Okay. Why do we have 24 in here?
Yeah, go ahead.
Originally, this ordinance required that roads meet no longer than 5,000 feet, but they could be extended up to 1,000 feet. And the board had waived the 1,000-foot maximum in favor of a much longer road. And several of the department heads were very upset with that. They were concerned that very long roads were being approved, and they didn't think that was the intent. There was a recommendation from the planning board to council to change this and this was done 3 years ago, to change this whole section, and the council tabled it because of the opposition from the department heads. So then it was kind of thrown back in their laps. They decided that maybe that they could live with a longer length if they had had some certainty that there was not going to be anything beyond that length. And so what was done is the length of the road was doubled from 1,000 to 2,000. But because you're lengthening the road, you're also incurring some additional risk that people aren't going to be able to have access. So they looked at what things that they could do to guarantee that there would always be access. One of the things they talked about is that they wanted to make sure that the road was going to be a certain width, because the wider the road is, the less chance there is of the whole road being blocked. Perhaps only a portion of the road would be blocked. If a tree falls over or an oil delivery truck skids, 24 feet is a little bit more than 20. Yes, this is not consistent with the most recently adopted road classification standards. Certainly that's something you can discuss if you want, but that 24 feet doesn't hit until the 1,001 linear foot length.
So are we going to have some funny shaped roads?
We may have some funny shaped roads, yes. But
some or some more?
That's it.
The other thing to keep in mind is, all an applicant has to do is create a second means of access. And it doesn't have to be a 24-foot wide town standard road. It can be an emergency access road, so they can have a road that's 2,000, 3,000 feet long, that dead ends to an emergency access road that's only open to emergency vehicles. And as long as they promise to plow that, and that connects up to a through road, they don't have to meet this 24-foot wide requirement.
Would we have a real problem decreasing that 24 feet to 22 or 20?
You can propose it. There's nothing that says you can't. This is a recommendation from the planning board to the town council. Anything you do is subject to further revision by the council.
It just seems to me the 2,000-foot road is obviously going to be a very much a neighborhood road. 24 feet, the safety issue aside just for a second, it seems to be overly wide for a road of that shortness or length or however you want to phrase it.
Any other board members have similar concerns?
I have some concern about it, but it's been a historical argument about once you get into a dead end road a certain distance that the requirement for getting emergency vehicles in there, and I don't see that there's a great difference between 24 and 22 feet, but, because we certainly originally when we started talking about this 4 or 5 years ago, we were talking about a much wider access lane than 24 feet. I guess I would not object to reducing it.
It seemed to me when we addressed the issue of roads, there was a very definite sentiment about on the board that the roads shouldn't be any wider than they had to be for all the reasons cited at that time, one being Stonegate and being used as an example of such a big swath of pavement cut through what was otherwise woods. And it seems to me we're sort of perpetuating the same situation we had before we addressed the road standards. And in this one circumstance, we're sort of going back to where we were before.
Any other? I guess the only I would pick up on Maureen's background on this, that we do have narrower roads, and one can build a narrower road. It's only when one exceeds a 1,000-foot length that the issue of safety becomes of greater concern, and therefore the width, which accommodates additional snow storage or accidents, potential accidents. Another alternative is simply to have pullover lanes, have a 20, 22-foot wide road, and have an area of refuge at some interval. I guess the concern I have is that I'm not in a position tonight to debate and decide where those locations would be. Perhaps we can pass this on to the council with an expression of concern for the pavement, overall pavement width, and ask the council to consider either a narrowing of that pavement width or including as an option to the wider pavement width, a narrower pavement width with pullover lanes, safety, refuse areas. And those could be discussed with the Public Works Director in terms of maintenance, safety, and any number of issues. But I guess for the purposes of this ordinance revision, I would prefer to see us move ahead this evening if we at all